As the former president of the American Civil Liberties Union, Professor Nadine Strossen has dedicated much of her life to the defence of free speech. Although the government has delayed its hate speech law changes until after the election, Strossen has been in New Zealand this week, meeting with officials to express her concerns about the potential for misguided reforms.
I have real concerns because although I could not be more opposed to hatred and more committed to reducing it, if not eliminating it, my observation, both in my country and countries around the world throughout history, is no matter how well intended the censorship laws are, they are at best ineffective in eliminating hatred, hateful attitudes, and hateful actions, and at worst, counterproductive. Often silencing disproportionately the very minority groups that they are intended to protect.
Do you have those concerns for New Zealand?
I do have those concerns for New Zealand. It's a very special country, Jack, but it is no exception to the general proposition that whoever has discretionary power to enforce such an inherently subjective, malleable concept as hate, hateful expression, predictably is going to use that power in ways that tend to reinforce existing power structures and tend disproportionately to silence political minorities, identity minorities.
Right. Okay. I think given the complexity of the subject, it would be helpful to strip things back to first principles. So under what terms is it necessary for speech to be restricted? And who should be responsible for restricting it?
You have asked exactly the right question. When is it necessary to restrict speech? And that is the standard under not only U.S. law, but international law under the United Nations and in many other countries. Government may and should restrict speech when the restriction is necessary to produce some countervailing goal of great importance, including personal safety, equality, dignity, national security. But that is exactly where these overly broad, overly vague hate speech laws fail, because not only do they not advance equality, they actually tend to do the opposite by coming back to silence those whose views are unpopular. So hate speech laws in the United States used to exist before the Supreme Court started strongly protecting freedom of speech in the middle 20th century. And whose voices were considered hateful? Those of Martin Luther King and other pro-civil rights demonstrators, those of anti-Vietnam War activists, those of advocates of the Rainbow Coalition rights and rights of everybody who was trying to change the status quo.
So is the threshold for speech that should be restricted only when it directly incites violence?
That is one example of speech that is, in fact, necessary to be restricted. We often call that the emergency standard. So intentional incitement of imminent violence that's likely to happen. But there are other examples. One example, Jack, is what we call a true threat. When I am aiming as a speaker at a particular individual or small group and intend to instill a reasonable fear that you're going to be subject to violence, or targeted harassment or bullying. Right. But there are also many other examples, such as defamation, perjury.
Yeah, there are other examples. But let's look at the law as it stands in New Zealand at the moment. As you know, efforts to alter New Zealand's laws on this front have been delayed for the time being. But currently under the Human Rights Act 1993, it's illegal to publish or distribute threatening, abusive or insulting words, quote, likely to excite hostility against or bring into contempt any group on the grounds of colour, race, ethnic or national origins. Is that an appropriate definition for speech that should be restricted?
No, because the concepts are so elastic, likely to incite hostility, that, and I can tell you, that kind of loose standard has been used in my country, and I assume it would be in yours, to suppress even really important perspectives on these issues, such as, you know, in the United States, we have a lot of debate about police excessive violence, including against minority communities. And yet we have the Black Lives Matter activist movement being attacked by many powerful officials as hate speech, as inciting hostility against white people, right, or inciting hostility against police officers.
See, it's interesting, though, because that law in New Zealand has been used extremely rarely.
I know.
And you think that it's still inappropriate for protecting speech?
I think it's inappropriate by definition. When it is rarely enforced, it's not doing anything meaningful to attack the root causes of these attitudes.
So what would be a meaningful change to that law?
To eliminate most of the language and confine it to intentional incitement of imminent violence or lawless action against anybody. Because all of us should be entitled to that protection.
Okay, so that is a really important point, because one of the concerns amongst advocacy groups in New Zealand is the groups that do and don't have protections under the law as it stands. So the groups at the moment, colour, race, ethnic or national origins, are the ones that have that protected status. So should religious groups, rainbow groups, disabled groups, other groups be afforded the same status?
Every individual should be protected against being targeted by intentional incitement of imminent violence or lawlessness. And by the way, every single one of us belongs to multiple of those categories, right? You and I belong to, you know, racial and gender and ethnic and religious categories, among others. But we're human beings entitled to freedom of speech, entitled to safety, entitled to equal protection under the laws.
I want to ask you about the activist known as Posie Parker. What did you think about her experience in New Zealand?
From what I have read, that she was not allowed to proceed with a speech that she had been invited to give in a public venue, therefore depriving her of freedom of speech.
How was she not allowed to?
Oh, I was heard that there were not only noisy disruptions, but that she was actually subject to physical assault, having some material thrown at her, and to menacing intimidation. And certainly, you could literally try to speak, but if you are in reasonable fear of your safety, that is, as I said, punishable even under very speech protective law, because you are, it's what we call the heckler's veto, where those who are objecting to her ideas are going beyond peaceful, non-disruptive protest and actually making it dangerous for her to proceed, therefore depriving her of free speech and also the freedom of audience members to hear what she has to say.
There's no doubt that she had some sort of tomato juice or similar poured over her. There's no doubt that in what was largely a very peaceful protest or counter-protest, there were small elements of argy-bargy, of pushing. I think one person was punched in the face. So all of those things certainly happened. If we were to imagine an alternative scenario where Posie Parker had come to New Zealand, had sought to speak, had sought a platform to speak, and those protesters had stood there without any argy-bargy whatsoever, without any sort of physical interactions with Posie Parker, but had simply shouted over her, would they not be exercising their rights to free speech?
They certainly would have the right to shout briefly, but if they are shouting in such a sustained manner that they prevent her from being heard and audience members from hearing her, that is an effective censorship, right? The message cannot be conveyed.
Right. So part of ensuring free speech is ensuring that people such as Posie Parker do have a platform.
Absolutely. Although, if you're talking about, say, a private university, you have no right to speak there. I had a great privilege, thanks to the organizing efforts of the New Zealand Free Speech Union, to be invited to the University of Auckland. I didn't have a right to speak there. It was a privilege. But if you're talking about a public venue, a public park, there is this notion that government may never deny access to that kind of open public facility based on disagreement with the viewpoint of the speaker.
It wasn't government, though. That's the point here. These were individuals who chose to turn up.
But if they invited her to speak, and
the government didn't invite her to speak.
No, but I'm saying if individuals in New Zealand invited her to speak, she was entitled to the opportunity. She wasn't entitled to get the invitation. But once she got the invitation, she was entitled to be heard by those who chose to listen to her.
But I mean, they could have theoretically invited her to a private venue where there would not have been protesters. Instead, they chose to hold it in a public space.
That is a very important right, because you want the opportunity to not only preach to the choir, but to try to persuade a larger audience, to educate a larger audience.
Not sure she persuaded many people while she was in New Zealand. In developed democracies right now, what do you see as the most significant threats to free speech?
Jack, in developed democracies, even where we have strong legal protection for free speech, we still have what is often called cancel culture, where people are unduly self-censoring, going beyond being polite and civil and courteous, but not talking about certain really important subjects for fear of being accused of being a racist or a transphobe, or, you know, and to our credit, we all abhor being targeted by those epithets. It shows what progress we've made toward equality. Mm. But when the result is that we are not debating important policies about these urgent matters of public concern, that is really dangerous. And that's a threat that I've heard is occurring here. It certainly is in the United States.
That's such a difficult balance, though, isn't it? Because free speech is not the same as being free from consequences of your speech.
Absolutely. And as you say, delicate balance is exactly the term that we use in American law. Mm-hmm. It's a matter of judgment and degree. And so there's a concept of disproportionality that also is an internationally recognized legal concept, that if people are so unduly punished and fearful of losing their jobs, being kicked out of school if they're a student, being shamed, shunned, and ostracized by their community, that goes too far. Certainly, robust criticism is to be welcomed and is an exercise of counter-speech, as we say. I wrote an entire book called Hate, Why We Should Resist It with Speech, Not Censorship. So I'm all in favor of counter-speech, but not disruptive protests that prevent the speech from going forward at all.
Finally, then, I know you've got to fly back. How are your meetings with New Zealand officials?
I have had a wonderful time. I have had the opportunity to meet with, for example, the president of the Law Commission and many interagency group of government officials who wonderfully are concerned about how do we reduce actual hatred and discrimination? How do we change the attitudes? How do we prevent and punish actual violence and discrimination? And I think saw a lot of support for educational initiatives, more speech rather than less speech.